Hello, everybody. I want to welcome you to our show tonight here in Treppendorf at Musikhaus Thomann in our beautiful amphitheater. Tonight, we're going to present the new brand Solar Guitars, and we are really proud to have the man himself. Welcome to Ola Englund.
Hallo, wie geht's? Ich heiße Ola Englund. That's about as much German as I know. But yeah, I'm going to speak some English because we also are on live stream, so people around the world can watch and learn of my mistakes. Like this, like not plugging on the amplifier before I go on stage. So enjoy this little awkward silence moment while I unplug or plug in my stuff, okay? If someone has a song that they like, they can start singing that in the meantime. No? Okay. So this is a very special day. This is the day we launch Solar Guitars through Thomann, and it makes me extremely proud because I'm personally a customer of Thomann since 2008-2009, and just for fun, I asked them, like, could you check on the total amount that I purchased here? We checked. Apparently there's 4 accounts with my name. So either I'm like a little stupid, or I forget passwords really easy. But we checked one account, 15,000 euros, which is kind of depressing. But that's what's so awesome with guitars and guitar gear, is that you get to spend a lot of money on it. It's awesome. And also, it's kind of a second premiere because we're also launching. We're not really launching, but I'm playing my signature amplifier, the Randall Satan 50, which is also available for pre-order here at Thomann. So you can listen. You know, if you like it, you can go buy one. It's a good deal. Okay? There's a note here, but it's not mine. Am I supposed to say this? All right. This is me, by the way, just talking. If you ever see my YouTube videos, it's just me talking and not playing that much, to be honest. I'm trying to change. I promise. What? Don't change, okay. Never play the guitar again, just speak. Perfect.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm gonna play a song. That's the thing, too. I didn't even introduce myself properly. I'm Ola Englund, by the way. I play in the bands Feared and The Haunted, and I also run a YouTube channel. Who has seen a video on my YouTube channel? Okay, almost everyone, except some dude back there. So, thank you. I'm going to start with playing a Haunted song, and this is a premiere. There's just a lot of premieres tonight for me playing a lot of these songs, so we just see how it goes. It's sort of like a gamble, but it's gonna be fine.
Okay.
Are you gonna shut off the microphone while I'm playing? Good. We'll be right back. Thank you so much. So, even though it's Solar Guitars Day, I kind of figured you might want to hear a little bit of my about my story going from, you know, the bedroom guitar player to where I am today, standing in front of you guys. And just, you know, to let you know how it kind of went about, because even if I'm standing up here right now, you and me, we're the same people, you know. Like it's, yeah, sounds stupid, but what I'm just meaning is like, I'm still that bedroom guitar player, like, you know, 10 years back. So there's no real difference between what I'm doing right now compared to what I did back then. So I just want to give you a perspective of my guitar playing life. So reason I started playing guitar was actually Nirvana back in the day. And you know, it's awesome with Nirvana because if you know like three guitar chords, you know half their songs, which is amazing. It's a great entry-level band if you want to start playing guitar, right? So pretty quickly after this, I started listening to Pantera. I heard the riff, you know, from Walk. I heard that and I was like, holy fucking shit. I'm gonna swear on this live stream as well, just so you know. Sorry. It's gonna demonetize Tolman's YouTube channel. Sorry. That's your problem, not mine. On my own channel, I bleep all my swearing because I need money, you know. That's how I, you know, go about life. But Tolman, they have money. I guess. So yeah, I started listening to Pantera, and this, like, when I heard Walk for the first time, I remember how it kind of blew my brains. Like, what the f is this distorted type of song? I never heard anything aggressive like this before. And it's like, you heard it, and it's like, wow, one guitar sounds like four guitars. That's basically Dimebag's tone right there. And it was actually this early that my interest for guitar sound started, rather than, you know, the actual guitar playing. And I know a lot of you guys are probably the same. You know, you buy stuff and you don't really play that much because it's just a lot of fun to own stuff and buy stuff and think that you're becoming better by buying stuff, which is fine. That's how the industry works. That's why it's blossoming and why Tolman is a great, great website. To spend your well-earned cash. Derailing, that's what I do. So I started with production, and I started to, you know, really try out amplifiers, and I had a Korg multi-effect pedal. I tried to dial on in the Dimebag sound and didn't really work, you know. And then after that, I was getting into home recording and, you know, miking up my amplifiers and my small combo. I had like a Squire Stratocaster and a Concert Fender amp, like a really small combo. I was like, how the hell, why isn't it sounding like Dimebag? You know, I'm playing the riff, but it doesn't sound like Dimebag. So it was kind of like a mystery that made me look into more about this, about, you know, guitar tone in general. So with that said, I think I'm going to play another song because I know I'm talking a lot. And when I'm talking a lot, I forget about time. Fortunate for you guys, there's a watch over there. So I'm going to keep my eye on that watch. Okay? So I'm going to play another Haunted song. And it's a mashup of two Haunted songs. So this will, I will probably fuck it up. But that's why I'm here.
So let's do this.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Yesterday, I was on a beach in Spain. Just a little contrast for it. I've been on vacation for like 1.5 weeks, and I hadn't really played guitar. So I got back late midnight, flew here 4 o'clock in the morning. So if you wonder why I'm speeded right now, it's because coffee is a good drug. Right, so about, where was I? Yes, home recording. When I started this home recording thing, I also started playing in bands. And you know, when you're a kid, you form a band with your best friends. That's what you do, because you don't have anyone else. You have, a drummer who can barely play drums, a singer who can't hold a note, and, you have two guitar players, and the one that's not good gets to play bass. And that's how you form a band when you're a teenager, okay? That's what we did. Fortunately for me, I knew two more chords than the other guitar player. So I got to be the guitar player. And we played punk rock. Good thing about punk rock is that it doesn't matter what you play. You can't hear shit anyways. So it's a good starting point. Then we started playing covers like Pantera, Sepultura, all our favorite bands, Machined. We're talking mid-90s somewhere, okay? And eventually, we started making our own songs. I started to write songs and, just trying it out. And we started recording demos and demos and demos. And at this time, while we were recording these demos at the studio, I was trying to feed as much as possible about the production, how to mic up a drum kit, a vocalist, or a guitar cab. So when we recorded demos, it was a great opportunity for me to learn more because I was still like 16, 17 years old. So I didn't really have a job. I was going to school and I didn't have any money. So I learned a lot from a producer near me. And eventually I thought that I could do it myself. So we recorded an album and I mixed and produced everything myself. And this band, we played for about 10 years together. And we played like the same venues in Stockholm. I'm from Stockholm, by the way, Sweden, not Switzerland. That's for the live streamers. I know the Germans here, they know the difference about Switzerland and Sweden, but not everyone does, okay? So this band, we were releasing demos, releasing albums and songs, our same buddies coming out to every show that we did, the same people, your friends basically coming to watch your shows. Nothing really happening with the band. And can some of you recognize yourself in this? That, nothing is really happening with your band, you're just standing at the standstill, and nothing is really evolving. There's a couple of hands here, but that guy, he has a video camera, so it doesn't count. Just holds up, yeah. So, anyway, in 2007, like 10 years later, we've been playing and playing and playing, nothing happening. We finally got a record deal. And for me, back in the day, like in the year of 2000, before this, new musical revolution, before Napster and Spotify, getting a record deal is priority one. That's what you wanted, right? You wanted a record label to release your album so you can go out on tour, get chicks, and play in front of real people and not just your buddies. So getting this record deal was like, yes. Huh? I can restrain myself from using the word fuck. So finally, after all these years of me working and working with this band, we finally got a record deal. And I was so happy. I recorded our album, produced it, mixed it. I even made like the website, the graphics for the album cover, everything. I put so much effort and time into this album. And I was like, okay, awesome. It's an awesome album. Great. The record company, they released the album. Awesome. 2 weeks later, the record company filed for bankruptcy. And so everything stopped at that point. And at this point, you know, I built so much, you know, I built up so much expectations with this that I got pissed off, obviously. And I'm not the guy that gets pissed off. If you see my channel, it's, yeah, I can drop shit on the floor, you know, coffee on my lap, and, you know, I just laugh. So pissing me off is kind of hard. But I was just so pissed off at this record company people for basically, they knew about this before, you know, they released the album. They could have told us, but they didn't. And I was just sick and tired of every other guy in my band at the moment. I mean, they were my friends. But, you know, I had put my heart and soul into this CD. And I kind of thought like, yeah, but you guys didn't do anything, you know? And some of the guys, I really wanted to make it as a band. I wanted to go out, play, and tour, you know, be a rock star. The other guys, some of them were just happy if they played the same venue over and over and over again. Just, yeah, I get to play live once in a while. It's fun. I wanted so much more. So I got sick and tired of these guys and basically said, fuck you. I'm out of here. This band is no more. So I quit the band and I'm going to play a song. Just leave you with a little cliffhanger with what's happening there. But the band the band disbanded. And yeah, and I'm playing another song. We'll be right back. Thank you so much. Welcome to the show. Have a seat. Oh, there's two for you right there. You're welcome. So, yes, band killed very angry Ola. But, you know, the result of this is that I decided that, okay, if I can't work it as a band, I'm going to do everything myself. So I'm going to form my own band, you know, and just do the drums, the bass, the guitars. I cannot sing for shit. So I found a guy, which was good, a Brazilian guy. He's called Mario. And we formed a band called Feared. This is 2007, 2008. And around this time came something, a phenomenon. It's called YouTube. Dun, dun. Around 2005, YouTube came along, and at that time, people basically had no idea what to use YouTube for. It was basically, you know, videos of cats, and that was basically it. But around this time, YouTube came along, and the cool thing about YouTube, and if you love gear like me, is that if you go to YouTube and you write Mesa Boogie Dual Rectifier, oh, you get millions, not millions, but hundreds of videos from people like you and me sitting in their basement, you know, recording their amplifier. Makes sense. It's not these, you know, angled Mesa Boogie fancy pantsy videos. It's honest videos, and we can get a perception of how a piece of gear sounds without having to move our asses from our office chair. So the only problem at this time was that basically every video sounded and looked like shit, because 2005, YouTube came along. The iPhone came in 2007. You know, everyone was using Nokia, you know, camera phones, and you know, the quality was like 2 pixels, 4 pixels, I guess is max, or 1. And you know, it looked like shit. So I, at that time, 2008, I got married to my my wife, my wife. We bought a super expensive wedding camera that we should that we used to film our wedding and, you know, honeymoon, and it had HD. What are you laughing at? We filmed our honeymoon, okay? Fucking perverts. We had this camera. It was a Sony high-definition camera, one of the first consumer high-definition cameras. And it was this big, costed like 1,500 euros, and it was shit, basically. It was half high-definition. But it was early. I used that camera because, you know, I had a couple of amps at home and felt like, yeah, maybe someone's interested in watching a video of me playing my amplifier. And, you know, I have a little bit of production skills, so maybe I can record myself while playing it. Makes sense. So I used my wedding camera and honeymoon camera and filmed myself playing an Engel Savage that I had and a Mesa Boogie Dual Rectifier, just sitting, you know, in my couch at home playing. And I uploaded it to YouTube, you know. And this, at this time, this was kind of early. Not many people did this in, like, in the production manner that you would put a microphone and mic up an a cabinet. So a lot of people started to follow me, and a lot of people in Stockholm, Sweden. I was part of a forum. I was part of two forums, Andy Sneap Forum, which is a recording forum. I learned a lot of my production there, and a Swedish guitar forum. On this Swedish guitar forum, it became like a thing of all the forum members that, oh, look at Ola. Maybe he can record my amplifier, or my amplifier, or my amplifier. So people wanted to borrow me or lend me their amplifiers. And so basically around 2008 and 2009, I was driving around Stockholm back and forth and picking up amplifiers and dropping them off all the time. It's just a lot of fun. I had a day job at the time. I was working as an accountant. So all of this on my spare time, weekends. And you can imagine how happy my wife was Friday evening when she asked what we're going to do this weekend. And I'm like, yeah, I'm going to go 2 hours out of town, pick up this amplifier, record it. Then on Sunday, I'm going to return it back. Awesome. Time for me. Not so much for her. But I'm still married. And yeah, you know, I love doing this so much. And this is how I stocked up on videos of amplifiers. A lot of people ask me, how the fuck do you afford all these amps? I did never buy them. I just lent the amps or borrowed the amps from people. And with this, I started to use Feared songs in my videos. And I played along to drums and shit like that. And with this, my YouTube channel started to grow. My Feared band started to grow as well. Makes sense. So I did this for a couple of years. I started doing tutorials as well. And in the beginning, I did not even speak. Oh, God. Oh, God, no. Sounded like you shit your pants. But it's just, yeah. So I did not even speak. I used like a text-to-speech to, you know, have my tutorials being made, how to record metal guitars. But these became very popular, and eventually I started to awkwardly speak as well after I gained a little bit more confidence, you know. And I did this, you know, I had my regular day job as an accountant, you know, getting kids, you know, we had a dog, everyday life, you know. I did all of this on my spare time, had loved it. It was awesome. In 2012, is it song time? Probably. This is a good cliffhanger. Okay. For everyone who has not been to one of my clinic, yeah. I see a couple of familiar faces. They probably already heard this story a couple of times. But I'm trying to make it better by not preparing and just being, you know, overly impulsive. Okay. In 2012, something happened that would change my whole career, musical career. Okay, very exciting. Okay. If you wonder what I'm doing right now, I have an EveryTune bridge guitar, and you tune, I'm just saying this quickly so you understand what I'm doing. You tune the guitar at the bridge, okay, and you set the tension here, but now I'm gonna drop it. So I can play drop songs, because the further into this workshop we get, the lower the tuning, because that's just more evil that way. Okay, good. Ola, shut the fuck up. Oh, good song. Let's do this.
Thank you. Thank you.
Very short songs. I just cut the songs because who wants to hear two or three verses and choruses? It's like, you just want to skip to the solo. Right? Okay. Yeah. Thank you. My water. Yes, I looked up my water. So in 2012, something happened. I had a signature guitar with a brand from the US, and I got the chance to go to NAMM. The big NAMM, Vietnam, no, not Vietnam. The NAMM 2012, summer, no, not summer, winter NAMM. I got there and, you know, to promote my signature guitars with this brand, Strictly 7 was the name, by the way. And I went there, you know, with no expectations, bringing my camera, you know, record every amplifier at NAMM, because that's my ambition right there. Like, there's, like, it's impossible. It's like 500 amps in that show. But my plan was to go from booth to booth, record videos, you know, stock up on videos for the next 2 years. So I went there, and I had an awesome time. I recorded a couple of videos because I understood that it was impossible to record every amp that was at the show. But when I got there, I wasn't ready for the fact that people recognized me and came up to me and said, like, hey, Ola, because of you, I bought this amplifier. Or because of you, I bought this pedal or this pickup. And thank you so much for your tutorials on recording myself at home. And I was so, you know, not ready for this. And they wanted to take pictures. And it's like super weird and awkward. It's like, oh, what? No, please don't touch me. No, not really. But I was just so overwhelmed with this feeling like, shit. These are real people. It's not these figures on your YouTube channel, you know, millions of views. Like, huh? What is that? Some Chinese dudes in, you know, like this. Or your mom, you know, sitting half a use. You never really see the real people behind this. So when I got to NAMM, it became very real for me instantly. Like, shit. Maybe I have something here that's kind of going somewhere. So overwhelmed with this awesome feeling, I got home from NAMM, and the next day on my accounting job, I quit my job. I said, like, okay, this is my chance where I think I can actually make this happen, because I got the confidence from NAMM, you know, meeting these real people that were nice to you and, you know, bought you a beer, and you were just happy. I was at the happy place. So I quit my job, and a couple of months after, I went to Frankfurt Music Messe to do the same thing, basically. You know, record videos, have a good time, drink some beers, because that's what you do here in Germany, I've heard. I went there, and I got a phone call from an American number on my cell phone during a dinner, and the guy on the other line was Chris Barnes. Chris Barnes is the, if you don't know who he is, he's the first singer of the death metal band Cannibal Corpse. And he has a band now called 6 Feet Under. Somehow, he found out about me because of my videos and thought I looked cool, which doesn't make any sense. And in some weird way, he found my number, which is even more creepy. Anyway, he asked me if I wanted to join his band, 6 Feet Under. They had a tour coming up 1 month after, a US tour. So I'm like, oh, okay. Is it okay if I call my wife? You know, I have a dog at home, you know, kids and shit. But yeah, I said yes, I joined 6 Feet Under. And for the rest of 2012, I basically toured with 6 Feet Under in the US, in Europe. I got to play Wacken, you know, in front of all those fucking people. That's too many. And it's, and you know, Summer Breeze, all those festivals. And it was like fucking amazing. You know, going from nothing and straight into a tour bus and go out play Wacken, you know, main stage. So it was a very big contrast. A lot of things happened there. And I also recorded their album, Unborn, I think it was called. I have a couple of songs on there. And yeah, so I mean, 2012 was just amazing, amazing. I love it to death. And shit, the time is running away. But yeah, later that year, I also joined another band, The Haunted, which also had seen me on YouTube, and they, you know, gave me a call. So within the within 2012, I got asked to join two half significant metal bands. And after this, I mean, I've been continuing to do my YouTube videos, as you've probably seen. But after this, just to mention, I've been asked to join maybe three or four significant metal groups after 2012. And it's all because of my YouTube channel. And you know why? They find me in some weird way. But the reason why they find me and see me is because I'm out there all the fucking time. Like right now, I don't know if you're on my channel, but I upload videos like three or four times every week. You know, I'm like a fucking virus. I'm in your fucking face all the fucking time. You know? And you're not gonna leave without my fucking ugly face. You know, when you go to bed, that's the last thing you're gonna think of when you go to bed. And this is how the music industry works today. I mean, having a record deal, what the fuck is that today? That's not worth anything, you know, at the level that I'm at, or, you know, at a certain... Of course, like, The Haunted has a record deal, and it works, you know, but it's because they're at a level that makes sense. But underneath that level, it doesn't make any sense to have a record label. That's not how people see you or hear your band. You have to be out there, like, all over the place. And do not fucking spam people like, hey, you know, put your CD in their faces and, you know, or like listen to my music in every thread or anything like that on a forum. You have to be an awesome person. And I'm not saying I'm an awesome person, but I'm just saying you have to be smart about how you're promoting yourself, because that's, you know, it's a deal breaker if people are going to listen to you or not, because the attention span of me and I guess a lot of other people is like 5 seconds. To listen to your music nowadays, because it gets served on a platter through Spotify and Apple Music and YouTube and Google Music. No one gives a shit about your album. Oh, awkward silence. Come in. It's harsh, but it's true. I mean, the album format is dead. It's been for a while. And, you know, if you look on... you know, Mel Sucks or whatever website you're on, look at what's being released this week. Just like 30 metal releases this week or something like that. It's an insane amount of music and bands competing for the same space. It's basically impossible for a band to reach out. And if you release an album, that album is dead after 2 weeks. Because there's, you know, next week there's 30 new metal albums that are better or, you know, caught the attention of fuckface somewhere, you know? So it's very depressing that I'm telling you this, but it's kind of true. I think people have to understand this, that if you're a band and if you're like, because I hear this a lot, people are asking me, okay, I have an album, how should I release it? My answer is always like, don't release the album. You're wasting an album of music if you're just releasing it without any plans for exposure or marketing. Marketing is everything today. And I've learned it the hard way because I've been doing it for a long time. So I know what works and, you know, what does not work. But for you, if you're in a band, you have to think differently. You have to go on YouTube. You have to do whatever it takes to get yourself out there. People are more likely to watch a video of yours than to just go to a streaming link and find you. If you make an interesting video, it's harsh to say, but if you like, you know, dancing with your dicks flapping around, you know, there's a big possibility that a lot of people are going to watch that video. It's sad because that's how we compete about exposure today. It's a fucking mess, to be honest. And even though I have, you know, a fair amount of views on my YouTube channel, there's 50 other channels just like mine, you know? So it's... for everyone, it's even getting harder. I mean, even for the big bands, it's getting harder and harder and harder. So my point of this story, I've been rambling a lot, It's just that you have to forget about the albums. Maybe you should release singles, you know, once every month. Just, you know, you have to have news all the time. As you might have seen with Solar Guitars, we're fucking pumping out models all the time. And we're killing it, basically. Because, you know, everyone's like, whoa, oh, another one there. Oh, shit, another guitar there. Oh, shit. We have news all the time. And that's why we kind of, you know, we grow quick. And that's the same with me. I have news all the time. I have a video coming out 3 or 4 times a week. It's a, you know, it's a virus. It's a marketing. Everything is marketing, basically. Do you understand? Yeah, everyone sounds super sad and depressed now. But it's the harsh truth. I'm trying to tell you before you spend way too much time on the wrong things. You need to reprioritize and think out of the box. Okay? Well, you're welcome. One guy got it. Awesome. Yeah. So I'm good. Thank you. Okay. I'm going to play one or two songs, but I have to talk about the guitar. Shit. So much, so little time. Ooh, should I play this? It's a fucking gamble. Should I do it?
Okay. It's just 2 minutes long.
Shit. Thank you. Shortest song in the history of workshops. But yeah, on to the guitars. Solar Guitars. Short recap on what happened. Like I told you, I was with a brand called Strictly 7 Guitars. Then I had a other brand called Washburn that had a Solar Guitar as well. And, you know, having a signature guitar with a brand is awesome, I must say. It's a privilege, you know. And even like Washburn, shit, Dimebag, you know, Randall, Dimebag. How the fuck did that happen? Like, that's faith, at least from my understanding. And the only problem is that, you know, my audience is not, you know, everyone. My audience is so scattered, you know, with social media and YouTube, all over the world. That's the beauty with social media, that we all come together from Ukraine to Pakistan, Iran, you know, from wherever in the world. And they can watch my shit, they can watch your shit and listen to whatever shit they want. It's a free world somewhere. And the problem with this is that we had guitars, but not everyone could get them. Like, fine, people could get them from different places and stores and stuff like that. But, you know, I had a remote audience. Like, how the fuck do some guy from Lebanon get a guitar? They're not in the stores there. And it's like, oh, but I need to reach out to these people. They want the guitars, but they cannot, you know, they cannot get it for some reason. And, you know, so my idea when I started Solar Guitars, and actually before I left Washburn, my good colleague Greg, that you probably met out here, he worked at Washburn. He quit Washburn and USM. And so I was like, yeah, you know, the people that I like are kind of like leaving the brand. It's like, it's not really going my way. I mean, it's not evolving in the way that I want, even though the Washburn guys are amazing. But it's like, I want to do so much more because I know, you know, I'm Ola. You know, I can be here, but I want to be here, you know? So I wanted to start my own brand, you know, because if I do it myself, just like with the band thing I told you, I can do a lot better myself than, you know, everyone else. Not really that cocky now, isn't it? But anyway, further in this planning, I asked Greg, like, hey man, could you help me out? You know, let's just make this kick-ass guitar brand. And it's gonna be fucking awesome for the end consumers. And the idea was that it should be available for everyone in the world. So today, I'm very excited because now they're also available through Thomann. And if you look here, these are not all the guitars, but right now we started with 15 models in December. And now I think we're up to how many? 24? 24 in since November. So we've really been, you know, we've been working hard. And I'm just going to go through really quick through this, through the different types here. And I'm going to see what is that? Oh. Okay, let's. This shape over here that you can see, the black guitar, you probably recognize it. It's the classic Ola England Solar shape, you know, with the bevels and you just look at it and it's like, yeah, it is a metal guitar. You're right. You know, it screams metal and it's just stealthy, and that's what I wanted all along. Like a guitar is supposed to look good on you, not look like shit. I mean, it's, at least for me, a guitar needs to look good. Obviously, it has to play good as well, but image is everything. Or is it? It is. No, it's not. Forget what I said. Guitar should look good. It makes me look a lot cuter, at least. That's what's important. So this is a Type A guitar right there, and I can't see what it is. Oh, it's a 7-string. So that's an A1.7 ETC. And it's a 7-string, obviously, with an Evertune bridge. And if you're looking around, you're probably going to see a lot of Evertune bridges on these guitars. It's because it's a feature that I truly believe in as a guitar player. It has saved me countless of hours in the recording aspect. And, you know, being in the home studio recording, I can, you know, record an album full day, you know, without tuning the guitar, put it in its guitar stand. Next day, I pick it up, and it's the same exact tuning. I don't have to. Before, I was like, okay, I made sure I was in tune between every riff when I recorded, just to make sure, you know. Now, with the Evertune, I can drop that bullshit and don't even have a tuner with me. I mean, I don't even have a tuner with me right now because I can trust this shit. And that's, I believe in it so much that it's in many of our models. And the Type A over there is available in a couple different shapes and forms. You've probably already seen them out there. Then we have the Type V. And you look at that and it's like, what the fuck? Wow. Shit. Okay. That's what I think, at least. Anyway, yeah. Same thing there. I mean, it has a tunematic bridge. All the guitars here have Duncan Solar pickups, by the way. And this is a tunematic bridge, ebony fretboard. It's a mahogany body, Grover tuners. Split. You can split. You cannot do. Yeah, you can do on this one. I forgot about that. Wow. Ola, good that you can check on your guitars. No, the reason why I'm thinking here is that the tone switch on the V's and the E's are splittable, so you just lift the tone knob and you split the humbuckers to, you know, for coil tapping, so you can sound like Yngwie Malmsteen. No, not really, but, you know, Eric Johnson or whatever, whoever fuckface uses a Strat or a Telecaster. So, So it's I don't want to leave anyone out. Okay. Okay, we have to move on. Forget about what I said about people playing strats. Over there we have a type S, which is a super strat, you know, classic shape with binding. And you just look at it, it's like, wow. That's elegance right there. That's like, okay, if you had a tuxedo, that's the guitar you should play. Did I mention that I'm kind of like impulsive and I have no idea what I'm saying? It happens a lot. I just come up with shit. And then we have the E-type. And the E-type is basically the newest shape that we've done, and we released it when we launched the brand. And we've been working so hard on this shape. And just, isn't that the most beautiful Explorer-shaped guitar you've ever seen if you're into metal? Yes, thank you so much for confirming and not disagreeing. Thank you. And it's available in a couple different options, whatever tunes, all of these guitars are. And as you can see, it has a beautiful swamp ash body. And you just look at it, it's like, yeah, just picture that on. The thing is, like, the great good thing about these guitars is that you buy one that you play, then you put that one on the wall. It's like, fuck, that's a piece of furniture right there. And then you just buy all of the guitars. Whoa, best sales guy ever. Good Ola. Yeah, so I understand that you probably already touched the guitars. After this, I think you're going to be able to touch them even more. And you should, because that's why we're here, for you to actually feel the guitars and get a perception. I'm not a sales guy. You know, I don't like bullshitting people. You know, these guitars, just go out and try them. If you like them, I'm happy. Makes me happy because, you know, I'm proud about these. And I can safely say that I can play any of these without any hindrance. And, you know, I want to make guitars that I would play, you know, and shapes that I would play. I do not want to make a shape that's like, it's a Telecaster that, it's cool, I guess, but, you know, I'm not going to play it. If I make a Telecaster, it has to be the best fucking Telecaster looking for me to play, okay? So all these guitars is something I would definitely play live. That's, you know, and I hope you kind of share my opinion about this. But maybe I'm just an idiot. Who knows? Okay, so maybe I should play... Oh, shit, the 7th string has been there, and it's like, oh, it's been screaming at you, like, yeah. Yeah, so I should probably end with the 7th string. And I think we're 1 hour in. Shit, not too bad, Ola. Yeah, sometimes I can go for 2 hours, but you're lucky today. If you want more of me, you know, I upload videos every week, you know? Okay, I'm going to switch to the 7th string, which is, it's just an added string, basically. I have a great idea. Does anyone have any questions? Yes, okay. I think we have a microphone for this. So, see you next year. No, there's a microphone coming for you. I think. There it is. Here it is. The guy in the front here.
Okay. I wanted to ask you how you got the idea for the emblem and the name of Solo Guitars.
Okay. So, the emblem, my wife drew that. And... No, I know. She's the best, you guys. Oh, my God. It's getting emotional. But it's good because I want more female subscribers on my YouTube channel. So, yes, awesome question. Thank you so much for helping me out. Solar name. I just figured of, you know, a name that kind of like, you know, Ola. Ola by itself is not that cool. And it's a female name in Poland. So it's like, nah. Solar is kind of close. So I thought like, yeah, that's kind of cool. So that's kind of like how we went with that name. And newsflash, Solar has Ola in it. but the thing is like, I don't want to put my name on this brand too much. You know, it's not like, you know, England guitars. you know, it's not my thing. I'm not, no. I want people to be able to play these guitars without the influence of this fucking blonde, you know? So, yeah, that's the reason for the name.
Thanks.
You're welcome. Anyone? Right, oh, you have to go. Oh, take that guy first. Thank you.
Two short questions. The first one, do you tweak the sound of your amp today or do you play straight through the amp? And the second question, do you use the Misha Mansur Precision Drive for recording or did you only use it for the one video why I bought it?
Oh, good. You see, people buy shit because of me. I'm guilty of people wasting money. Okay, first question. What was that again? I forgot already. Yes, okay, yeah. For this, because I have the Satans here, I usually, when I play live, I bring an AX8 pedal because it's just very convenient. I can play into whatever shit I want. Right now, I'm playing cable straight into... Oh, it's a wireless microphone. I can do the Britney Spears things. No. Okay, so right now, I'm playing guitar straight into this Fortin 33 grind. 33, not grind, sorry. And then into a Fortin Soul noise gate, and then into the amplifier. And then at the back here, I have a TC Electronics flashback delay. So three pedals, basically. And hang on, maybe I can showcase a little bit. And the reason why I use an overdrive at times is because I'm scared and frightened that I do not have too much gain. But I'm going to show you, okay? Without the... I could do that all day. It's fun. Okay. Misha Mansur, yeah. That's the good thing about the Satan 50 is that you have all these pre-filters and pre-gains, so you can basically shape whatever distortion you want. So if you want a fuzz distortion, go ahead. That's your thing. Misha Mansur Precision Drive. I have used it a little bit. And it's usually, I have like three or four different go-to overdrive pedals. This Fortin 33, which is quick, sounds awesome. The Precision Drive, which is has more options. Ibanez Tube Screamer TS9. It's a classic. Sometimes it's like, okay, fuck all these new overdrives. This fucking old TS7 or TS9 is the fucking shit. So like it varies. Some days I'm a 33 guy, some days I'm a Precision guy, and some days I'm like TS9 guy. That's what's awesome with gear. You can just stack up in your closet somewhere. That's what I do. Did you have another question?
No.
Thank you so much. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Run. We're out of time. Don't run. Be careful.
Well, first off, hello from South Africa, and...
Holy shit, okay.
Yeah, my question is actually more related to your YouTube channel, and that is, what do you think about, or have you heard of Spectre Sound Studio, and what do you think of...
Of Glenn?
Channel? Yes, exactly.
Glenn is a character. No, I love Glenn, he's awesome. He's actually, we've talked about... We actually know each other, Glenn and I, from the Andy Sneap forum, because he was also there. And so we actually talked, you know, since 2005, probably. So it's, yeah, he's awesome. He does his thing, super awesome. And yeah, I just think he doesn't swear as much now. I wish he did. You know. Yeah. Huh? Good. Hi. Maybe he's watching. Hi, Glenn. I love him. Don't cup the microphone, bitch.
Okay, Simeon, do we have some questions from the community?
Yeah, we have some questions from YouTube. Question number one, how does the Evertune bridge make the sound, the guitar sound any different? How does it affect the sound?
It's not, the Evertune is not sounding exactly the same like other bridges. Like, but if then again, if you compare a fixed bridge against a Floyd Rose bridge, they're not sounding the same either. So, in my opinion, the difference is not worth mentioning, I guess. I mean, it's like, fuck. I don't know, I think it sounds pretty good. Thank you.
Another question is, are there any plans for 8-string models?
You know, I like to not talk that much about what I have in my head, because you don't want to give away everything about everything. But you know, my head is filled with shit. There's probably going to be an 11 string at some point. No, I have no idea. I mean, it's like, you know, we'll just see, okay? But if you think of it like this, okay, how many... Okay. How many guitar models have you already launched since our launch? No, 8 months ago. A lot. So we're not stopping anytime soon. So chill the fuck out. Have some patience and maybe we'll make an 8-string. I have no idea. Wow, I'm the best with questions, by the way.
Okay, this is an easy one. All-time favorite song. And why?
That's a hard one. It's not an easy one. Shit. Yeah. Bubble Bobble. You know the video game Bubble Bobble? I really like that song. It's a good song.
Can I play it?
Yeah. Fuck it.
Yeah.
I love that song. No, I don't know. Shit. No. I cannot pick a song. It's probably every Pantera song. Yay. Yay. Pantera. Fuck yeah. Rest in peace, Vinny Paul, by the way.
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead. Oh, there were only 3 questions on the live stream. Sorry.
No. Is there a new Haunted record coming out soon?
Not that I know of. No, I mean, it's, who knows? Like I said, I don't like to talk about stuff that I have in my head. It's why spoil the surprise? And now it's like, it's sounding like it's coming pretty soon, but it's not. Or is it?
One user is asking, do you have any tips for polyrhythmic djent patterns for beginners?
No. No, polyrhythmic. What? Is it? Is it? What, gallops? I don't know. Just practice slow. I like everything. Practice slow. It's simple. Yeah. You don't start quick. You start slow. Just like with your sexual debut and yeah. You start slow.
That's for now.
That's for now. Yeah. Good end note there. Okay, maybe I should play that that last song. And then after that, maybe we can hang a little bit, okay? And you can try out the guitars. I'll be out there, sweaty. If you want to give me a hug, I'm super sweaty. But I'll take a picture with you, you know, and, you know, just chill for a bit. I'm just going to go and wash myself off, you know. And so I'll run away, but then I'll come back. Good. So I'm going to skip a song. Who's calling? Not me. Is this on? On. Hello. It's all right to mosh if you want. Okay? Be ready. Not yet. Just one short segment left. Guys, thank you so much for coming. Live stream audience, thank you so much for watching. Tolman, awesome.
Thank you so much. See you out there, okay?